for those who are new to my channel, small intro. I have been sailing at sea for almost 18-19 years, and last 7 years I have been master on product tankers. I have done Suez Canal transit many times. Let's start with explaining the title. My title says Marlborough Canal. Yes, because when you are about to transit Suez Canal, even before boarding, these pilots ask you for cigarettes. And they really trouble master a lot for cigarettes. You know, these pilots can go up to that extent to put the ship in danger just for some carton of cigarettes. Suez Canal Authority is charging very high cost, between $100,000 to $400,000, depending upon the size of the ship, depending upon the size of the tonnage you are going to transit through the canal. But at the end, these people are like workers. You know, they don't get that cut from that high tolls. They are working on fixed salary, so these people are really corrupt. Everything is a lot of corruption there. If you have signed off from any Suez Egyptian port, you will exactly know what I'm talking about. Now, what has happened? A 400 meter long ship, 59 meter wide ship, has blocked the Suez Canal diagonally, causing the world's most expensive traffic jam. How it happened? So far we know that there was very strong southerly wind. That means the wind was coming from south direction. Very strong wind can really impact a large ship having a large windage area. This wind will not be just the wind, it would have come with a sand storm, causing some problem in visibility as well. So your ship is navigating at a low speed, say around 3 knots, 5 knots, then the effect of this wind will be very high. But if your ship is more than 10 knots, 12 knots, then the effect of wind will be less. This ship in particular was coming on a northbound transit. It was coming from China and going to Europe, and on the way it got stuck. It would have never thought that this will happen. This is one of its kind incident in the history of Suez Canal.
There's a 5-degree set here which can be seen, which is the difference between heading and course over ground, which is normally caused by wind and current, but in this case it's mainly because of the wind. There's hardly any lateral current in the canal. Ever Given is entering the canal at 8 knot speed, hardly any rate of turn. Again, same story, about 5 degrees set, and speed has increased to 9 knots. Wind is pushing the ship towards the left side of the canal. At this point, speed is 11.4 knots. As you can see, heading and course over ground is same, about 035. As the ship is coming on a northerly heading, wind from south is neutralized. At this point, she is doing fine. Speed 12.8 knots, 5 degrees set, and she is turning to port, which is required as per her next course. Here she is almost at a northerly heading, no set, doing a speed of 13.7 knots, middle of the channel, looks good, but she is not able to steady her course, and according to me, massive problem has just started now. What is actually happening between pilot master and bridge team will be known after the investigation, but what I can see from my experience that at this point on a straight course, she should have easily able to steady her course, especially when the winds are from stern. Now just forget everything, just have a look at the rate of turn. It is swinging from port swing to starboard swing to port swing, and high rudder angles have been used. 8 degree rate of turn, and ship is going from right to left of the channel using high rudder angles. Error in navigation cannot be ruled out at such a high speed of almost 13 knots. At 13 knots and wind from stern, visibility may be a factor here that the ship has completely lost control.
This traffic jam is inducing losses about $400 million. Per hour. Yes, exactly, per hour. So how this loss is so high? Because it's not the one ship which is blocked the channel. So many ships are waiting to cross the channel. So many ships have time-bound delivery, and their schedule for next 3 months, 6 months is fixed, especially on a container trade. If you're on tanker, yes, understand, there will be few days delay in delivering the cargo. You just have to pay for the delay. Now let's just compare, if this ship doesn't use this Suez Canal and come all the way around south of Africa. For example, if you are coming from Colombo to Rotterdam via Suez, your distance will be 6,800, about 22 days sailing at 12.5 knot speed. This distance will increase to 10,500 nautical miles, 35 days sailing at 12.5 knot speed. That means straight away increase of 13 days sailing and that much extra fuel. What can be the solution? Solution is already in progress. Dredging, lightering the ship. I think the most effective way to find a solution is to lighter the ship. You remove the cargo from the ship, ship will become light and her draft will reduce. She will automatically float free. Poor contingency arrangements at Suez. These Suez people should learn from Panama Canal, or they should learn from a big ports like Rotterdam and Singapore, where you know they are well equipped with very high capacity cranes, discharging facilities to deal with the oil pollution. They have the team ready. Next to the canal, they don't even have any tracks to get the cranes, or they don't even have a proper roads along the canal. They don't have tugs standby for emergency. Even during the pilotage waters, they don't keep your anchor in ready to go position. Ready to go position means, you know, lowered all the way up to the water level, and they don't even have a requirement to keep somebody forward. A big accident doesn't happen like this. It's a chain of events which finally lead to such an accident. Even today, if you see, these people will have a wooden boat. They will place it on the main deck. 2-3 people will stay on board. All they will do is to sell, you know, local items, and they'll be after somehow to get your coffee, meals and cigarettes and whatnot. You know, they can go up to any level, including the pilot. So entire transit, their main interest and focus is to get maximum gifts from the ship. You know, gift or bribe is the same thing. Corruption in this country is at its peak. I have personally signed off, and you could see at every stage there is corruption. They will expect you to pay them $10, $15 in order to not have your bag checked. And same goes with the pilots. There is no arrangement from the Suez Canal Authority to frisk these pilots when they come back from ship, you know, what they are bringing, so they can have a control. This kind of control is working very well in ports like Singapore and Rotterdam. Inside a bridge picture is horrible during the Suez Canal transits. None of us masters want our ships to transit Suez Canal because of the hassles and difficulties we have to face from the beginning till the end. Every time we'll have a pilot change, new pilot have his new requirements. He will expect more and more cigarettes and cartons and all these things. And in a way, I would say unofficially, even companies expect that you give them cigarettes and just get the ship out safely somehow. But this is not a permanent solution. Small incidents leads to such big accidents finally. I know for a fact that these pilots threaten master. They intentionally give you wrong helm order, wrong engine movements. Sometimes they will give you so many engine movements, you know, for which the ship is not designed. You will lose all your bottle pressure and you don't have engines. And same goes for steering. They will shout, they will try to abuse, they will do anything to get the master, you know, under pressure to give him bribe. Now, what is the solution? This is mainly for some junior masters or masters who are new. Immediate solution to this problem is that no matter what charter you are, for a tanker, I always tell them that this ship is Shell charter or BP charter, because these people know that Shell and BP, they have very strict anti-bribery policy and you cannot get anything from them. Once you tell them that this is a Shell or BP charter and my charter doesn't allow any gifts, and I have a camera installed on bridge which live feed is going to the office and voice is being recorded, once you tell them, normally the pilot starts to behave okay. So this is one. And second thing is food, coffee, tea, all these things, you know, you can be polite with them and you can try to get as much friendly with them as possible. During my last transit, pilot wanted to smoke on bridge, and on my ship, my bridge is no smoking, so I obviously refused them for smoke. And then the same pilot told me that if your bridge is no smoking, just inform the authorities, they will get you a non-smoking pilot. So since then I am following that practice, and I always send a message to agent that my bridge is no smoking, so please send me a no smoking pilot, and they do that and it works very well. Is this incident good or bad? It is bad because there are so many millions and millions of dollars of losses, schedule change, and loss is not for one ship, it's for the entire industry, it's probably for the entire global trade, and it will probably affect everybody. So with that regard, it is bad, but in a way it's good, because if you see the history, all these such big accidents have led to a new convention, new rules, which have made shipping safer. I hope that Suez Canal Authority are better prepared for dealing with such emergencies in future. Pilots start behaving better with the ship, and to all the interests, Suez Canal Authority need to be strict with their employees and take very bold and big steps. Next one, money matters most. What Suez Canal had never any problem of width like Panama Canal. They always had sufficient width. All their problem was for the depth. They kept digging, they kept increasing the depth of the ship. They started to accommodate bigger and bigger and ship large tonnage, large money, but they never cared about the safety aspect. For example, recently Panama Canal has lost few centimeter of water level, so they have reduced the maximum allowed draft for the canal as well. But these kind of steps, you know, stopping the canal if the weather is bad or if there is any problem, they are not thinking in those terms. They are just thinking somehow they need to pass around 50 ships every day and earn that money. Last year during Corona times, many of the crew members had done about 10, 11, 12 months on board, and the situation was mentally was very bad. One of the Filipino crew members jumped in the Suez Canal and swam across and was sitting on the side of the canal. What Suez Canal authorities did, they hired a tug. 6 hours it took for the tug to arrive. They put him on that tug. They stopped the ship on the other side of the canal and they waited for the crew. They put him back on board, but they never really cared. Being a port state, you have to care about these things as well, you know, that crew are being relieved on time or not. If they send back home one person, then many will start jumping, and you know, they are not concerned about these things, MLC or crew rights or crew welfare, nothing. Their aim is just to pass the ship somehow and earn the toll. And last one, there are so many videos on YouTube about the incident, but only one person on Instagram I've seen, Captain Thomas from Merx, whose heart was going out for the crew on board of that ship. Imagine the situation of the master. It will be very horrible and it will be very stressful. So I hope they are dealing well with this pressure, and I hope the ship is free and everything is back to normal soon. For any reason, if you like this video, please hit the like button. Do not forget to subscribe if you haven't done that already. Stay fit. Jai Hind. I will see you on the next one. They will have their shops, क्या बोलेगा उसको यार, with a wooden boat, they place it on the ship. अरे क्या बोल रहे हो यार, ठीक है वीडियो प्ले कर दो, EP port to port यहाँ पे प्ले कर देना. What was that? What I do, I will, क्या बोल रहे हो यार, सब गड़बड़ हो रहा है, okay? All the way around south of Africa, क्या बोल रहे हो यार, English का बोलने का खत्म नहीं, perfect है अपना.